Hi everyone, my name is Luciano Tozzaro. I'm a customer engineer at Google Cloud, working with AI machine learning. Specifically, today we're gonna talk about quantum machine learning with Vertex AI. Vertex AI is a solution that Google Cloud launched last quarter, and it used it to help data engineers and data science to develop the end-to-end machine learning pipeline. So let's start with a bit of theory because I know that not everybody is familiar with the concept of quantum computing, specifically with quantum machine learning. So let's refresh our memory. Google's quantum, beyond the classical experiment, we used 53 noisy qubits to demonstrate it could perform a calculation in only 200 seconds on a compute on a quantum computing that will take 10,000 years on the largest classical computer using existing algorithms. So basically, that opens the beginning what we call the noisy intermediate scale quantum computing era. Quantum compute relies on properties of quantum mechanics to compute problems that would be out of reach for classical computers. A quantum computer uses qubits. Qubits are like regular bits in a computer, but with the added ability to be put into a superposition and share entanglement with one another. We're gonna review what means superposition and what means entanglement, okay? But for now, let me explain a little bit what is quantum machine learning. Quantum machine learning is built on two concepts, quantum data and what we call the hybrid quantum classical models. Basically, quantum data is any data source that occurs in a natural or artificial quantum system. That means it can be data generated by a quantum computer, like the samples that we have here. For example, in Google, we have the Sycamore processor for Google's demonstrations of quantum supremacy, for example. And we needed to think about what is the hybrid quantum classical models. That is very important. Basically, a quantum model can represent and generalize data with a quantum mechanic origin. Because near-term quantum processors are still fairly small and noisy, quantum models cannot generalize quantum data using quantum processors alone. That's why, for example, since TensorFlow already supports heterogeneous computing across CPUs, GPUs, and TPUs, the tensor processing units that only Google provides, it is used as the base platform to experiment with the hybrid computing class algorithms. And that's exactly what we call what we're gonna do today. And let me introduce some concept that I think is important for the understanding. First of all, the first question is probably, what is a qubit? So if you abstract from the physical world, a classical bit is just one of two states, zero or one. And you might have heard of qubits having states between one and zero. And I had implicit imagined them like this before I started learning more about quantum computing. And turns out the reality is more interesting. If you see this, basically, imagine a sphere, just the surface without the interior. Okay, now pick the topmost point on it, the North Pole, for example, and call it zero. Similarly, take the South Pole and call it one. Okay, these two states correspond to the classical one and zero. In the entire surface contains all possible states of a single qubit. Basically, zero and one here are not numbers, but just symbols. In fact, the funny notation stands for 2D vectors of complex numbers, but we will only use it for qubit states, okay? Also, the sphere representation is just that, representation. It doesn't have to correspond to the physical reality. That's the main concept here. This is called the block sphere. Here it is with an arbitrary state, and we can represent this with x, y, and z axes. So there are indeed states between 1 and 0, but there are actually 2 degrees of freedom, if you see. So we typically have a classical processing, computing algorithms, or more classical algorithms in this. And the most important thing is that you can only extract one bit of information out of a qubit. So that is a very good information. And do you remember the concept about entanglement and superposition? Those two are very important to provide you the context of what is quantum computing. Entanglement is a property of two connected qubits where the measurement of one changes the state of the other. In superposition, that means a principle of quantum mechanics that states that when a qubit state is measured, half of the time the state is zero or the other half, the state is one more than zero. So the superpositions seems counterintuitive, but the phenomenon has been confirmed in many experiments and it is essential to the quantum computing. So that's the representation of superposition. Basically, it's not zero and one at the same time. A superposition of two states is another state. And this is the vector representation of this with some coefficients. So we need to understand the single qubit operations. For example, we have the poly X. This is another concept that is very important to understand, to see how we can calculate this. So I believe linearity of quantum computing is one of the reasons why quantum computers can be fast. But the question is, we now have the qubits and know how to flip them, but how do we talk about this? So let's represent this in a circuit. So the quantum circuits is another concept that is very important to understand before play with this. The classical bits are the double lines here, and usually we don't care about the individual bits. So we write them as a net register slash with the count. So like you can see the comparison between the classical register and a register with the qubits. So, and the last thing that I would like to share with you is about an example from two researchers, Deutsch and Soja, and they basically just a circuit example, not going to details on the algorithms, but just to you understand that we don't care about what happens to the last qubit, for example. And we have here what we call the Kirk, the circuit simulator, that is important to understand how the block sphere that we saw 3 or 4 slides ago and the probabilities for the overall system. So let's recap the main concepts here. Just to put it clear, quantum computing is a new era and we are not prepared to explore all the potential that we have because we are in the early stages. We need to, for example, correct the quantum error computations before we can apply quantum computing in the real life in a practical way. So basically, quantum computing will not replace right now the classical computer because many classical problems in algorithms are best suited for a traditional computer like you're going to see in our demo here. So the concept of qubits is very important. Understanding what it is a gate, that means the circuit inside a quantum processor which manipulates the qubit state. We need to understand what is a circuit, an arrangement of gates to perform a quantum computation. And we're going to explore Circ. Circ basically is a Python library for rewriting, manipulating, and optimizing quantum circuits and running them against quantum computers and simulators. This library was developed by Google Research and the Google Quantum Computing team. And we're going to use this. We're going to install Vertex AI in order to perform our exercise. And just for curiosity, the quantum supremacy is a milestone in which the quantum comp is when basically when a comp quantum computer quickly completes an algorithm that would take a classical computer and practically a long time. So Google and NASA, we achieved that in October 2019 when he published the results of the experiment using the CKMOR processor, completed an algorithm in only 200 seconds in a quantum computer. That would require 10,000 years on a classical supercomputer. So that's the potential that we can explore in the future with that. So let me give you a brief introduction about Vertex AI and why Google Cloud is investing in this technology. Basically, Vertex AI provided tools to support the entire machine learning workflow and thinking about the end-to-end machine learning pipeline. So we are ready to treat the since the data readiness, the feature engineering phase, the training in the hyperparameter tuning, the model serving, the understanding and tuning of the final results, implement this on an edge computing strategy, deploy the model in production in an online or in a batch way. We have the model monitoring, just to identify outliers or concept drifts that can occur. And we have the model management, where we can retrain the model automatically. We have several components here, and I'm just looking for explain the most important ones. But that's a lot of things. What one should choose to use? So basically, if you don't want to train your own model, you can explore our pre-trained APIs. We have at Google Cloud several AI APIs that you can consume as artificial intelligence as a service. But if you want to train the model using your data, but you have two options. You can write your code yourself. And if you decided to don't write your code, you can use AutoML. Google AutoML is a tool that helps, especially the data analysts, because they don't have too much knowledge about machine learning concepts and they are not familiar with Python and R. They can build and deploy machine learning models without code. So AutoML basically is a low code or no code tool. But if you have a data science team and they are interested to write their models with their data, you can customize the model. That's we have the AI platform at Google Cloud to do this. So like I mentioned to you, we can explore artificial intelligence as a service using the pre-trained models, where we train the models using Google data and they are ready to use. Just plug and play in your application. If you want to customize, but you don't want to write code, you can use basically what we called AutoML. With AutoML, we just need to upload your data set. If it is an image, is in a tabular way, if it is a text, or if it is a video, and you can explore the possibilities here in terms of which model you should use. So basically, as I said, we have how to train a machine learning model for an image classification or object detection. And we can treat, for example, a time series. We can have a possibility to create a model for a demand forecasting or sales forecasting using several econometrics and machine learning algorithms to that. And of course, we can explore what we call unstructured data, analyzing, for example, text files and apply a natural language processing over it. And we have also the possibility to classify videos and have the what we call the object traction or object tracking, just to identify tracking label objects in a video segment in movement. So for build, train, and evolution, in evaluate a model, using, of course, the two alternatives, we need to choose what we want. But basically, AutoML is ready just to upload your data set and choose what kind of business problem you want to solve, if it is a regression or a classification, if it is a forecasting, etc. But now we're gonna focus on the custom training models. Basically, you can build an environment. We can choose, including the framework that you want to use. For example, you can choose a Python or a R. You can choose a machines with GPUs, for example, or only CPUs in a distributed training jobs. And you can, for example, integrate that and we can deploy in a scalable way with endpoints that you can integrate, and you have how to automatize the process of your pipeline creation. And of course, here we are exploring the Jupyter Notebooks solution or the Jupyter Labs, integrated, for example, with a Git repository for optimize the code versioning and control, especially when you are working with a collaborative environment. And everything is integrated with the Google Cloud tools and platform. So here is an example how we can integrate the notebooks with your Git bucket. And what kind of scenarios we should use this? So basically, we are concerned about the ML ops. So we can help you to product, basically apply what you call the CI/CD, the continuous integration, the continuous delivery in this thing. So thinking about what we are bringing new in the platform, we are bringing for you guys a feature store, a model to do the experiments, the whole orchestration with machine learning pipelines using Kubeflow on the hook, and we have a machine learning metadata repository, and we have continuous monitoring of the performance of the models. So basically, we can provide a whole suite for machine learning operations, what we call the ML ops. The feature store, we can share and use the machine learning features over several different use cases, and we can deploy the models in several different ways. So the pipeline can help you to automatize the workflow. So since the experiment, the retraining of your model, the model deployment, and the continuous monitoring, you have the backbone of what we need to put the machine learning system in production. And you can manage the pipeline leveraging a Python SDK and the methodologies of TFX, the TensorFlow methodology to put in production, apply the MLOps in production as well. So you have an automated, scalable, and serverless, and cost-effective environment to deploy the machine learning models. And basically, we have as a difference the possibility to have the continuously monitoring to identify what we call the concept drift, is when the distribution of the new data that is being ingested is very different from the distribution and the behavior of the data that you use to train your machine learning model. So basically, the model monitoring will help you to identify that things, that phenomenon. You can set automatically alerts or alarms so that the data science and machine learning engineers can change the model according to the performance. And we have reliability and confidence that the model that is in production is performing very well. So using Vertex AI throughout your machine learning workflow is the solution that we think any company applying machine learning artificial intelligence should use to automatize the machine learning pipeline and implement this machine learning workflow. So basically, we have several resources at your disposal in our Google Cloud website. We have best practices to implement machine learning and MLOps in production. We have some started docs so that you can understand more how Vertex AI really works. So giving this introduction, where we review the concepts of quantum computing, and now you are familiar with what is Vertex AI, let me jump to the Google Cloud console so that we can see a real example of quantum computing machine learning. Here we have the Google Cloud Platform console. And of course, we have several services here in Google Cloud, since BigQuery, that is our analytics database. But now we're going to focus on Vertex AI. We have, as I presented, all the models that we need to have this MLOps and machine learning end-to-end pipeline implemented in production. Here, we're going to focus on what we call the notebooks. We can, of course, control your data sets, control your features using the feature stores, etc. But let's jump to the notebooks, and I'm going to show you how can you provide the environments. So basically, here in the notebooks, you can create some instances. So let me give you an example. When you want to create a new instance, you can customize this instance, choosing the framework and the main libraries that you needed to use. For example, if I want to use Python version 3 only, I can include the scikit learning library. That's the most famous library for machine learning and data science in the world. We can have already Pandas library just to make the data manipulation. But we're going to focus on a TensorFlow solutions, especially the TensorFlow quantum computing library. So I created here a TensorFlow environment, and I used the last version of TensorFlow Enterprise. And creating this environment, I have, for example, the possibility to have Keras. That is another library that is basically running TensorFlow in the back end. And I have, for example, the natural language processing toolkit to work with text and natural language use case. So here I can have the possibility to create this environment using only CPUs, or I can add NVIDIA Tesla T4 GPUs, especially when we are working with deep learning, is just an accelerator for this kind of tasks. So here I created basically two environments. One environment is just using a Python tree optimized for NVIDIA. So we're gonna use the CUDA DNN for that. And we can see that in this environment, the configuration of the environment I can change. For example, I can change if I need more memory or if I need more CPUs. I can put more vCPUs, that means the cores for processing. And we have different scenarios and different instances according to the workload that you need. For example, we have specifically with the compute optimized environment, and we have another one with memory optimized, with a very huge environment with more than 106 vCPUs and almost 4,000 gigabytes of memory RAM. So here, because I don't need to run this in live, I'm just creating this quantum computing environment using TensorFlow and a GPUs, of course. And when you open the JupyterLab, you will find an environment like this, pretty much very similar with the environment of a Python Jupyter notebook. And I, of course, created my code here. In this first notebook, we're gonna use the quantum neural network. It's basically the traditional neural network, but applying the quantum concepts. So we're gonna build a quantum ne neural network model to classify a simplified version of MNIST. MNIST is a very famous data set with a set of images. So we're gonna use an approach used in a paper that is published by this guy, Fari, and others research. And the idea here is the perform is just check that how is the performance of a quantum neural network with the classical data. We are not using quantum data here. And compare the performance of this quantum neural network with the performance of a classical neural network. Okay, so since I'm using an instance that is already installed TensorFlow, I don't need to reinstall TensorFlow again. I just need to call the TensorFlow library, STF, but I need to install using the pip install function the TensorFlow quantum library. That's the main difference here. Using the TensorFlow quantum library, we can, of course, apply that to build our quantum neural network. Just important importing the most used libraries, and I would like to emphasize basically these two. Of course, you are familiar with NumPy and seaborn, of course. But the new thing here is the Circ, that is the library that Google created to handle with quantum compute processing. And we're gonna explore the SymPy. The SymPy is not new, it's not so very often used. But do you remember that SymPy is just a symbolic computation? It provides the computer algebra capabilities for mathematical models. So we're gonna load the data. Basically, you know that the MNIST is in the library of Keras, so it's one of the data sets that is already in Keras. So we just need to load the raw data from Keras, and you're gonna feature the data sets to only threes and six. Okay, and we need to adjust the size of the images so that we need to downscale the image so that we can fit in a quantum computer. We will remove any contradictory example, like for example, six and nine and stuff like that. We're gonna convert the binary images to a circuit using the circ library, And we're gonna convert the circuits to the TensorFlow quantum circuits, okay? Basically, loading the data is very easy. You just need to see. Here we're gonna see the difference between the original training examples and the original test examples. Now we need just to filter that because you just want to use the threes and six, okay? For example, let me print one example. This is a number three. We need to adjust the scale of the images from 28x28 to 4x4. So we're gonna use the resize of TensorFlow in NumPy. And now we see an example how it is. And we're gonna remove all the contradictory examples. This is an approach that Fari put in the section 3.3 just to avoid any kind of problems. This is not a standard machine learning procedure, but is included just for the interest to follow the paper of Fari, okay? So now the result counts to do not close and match the reported value. So basically here, now we're gonna see the number of unique images is a data set with pretty much a little bit more than 1,000 images. We have the unique trees, the unique seeds, and basically now we're gonna encode the data as quantum circuits. So here we're gonna explore the threshold in the library. So basically here we are using the same approach that Fari used in the paper. That means representing each pixel with a qubit with the state depending on the value of the pixel. So the first step here is to convert to a binary encoding. So the qubits at pixels indicates with value that exceeded the threshold that we set, 0.5, are rotated to an X gate. You remember the concept of gates? That's very important to understand what we are doing here in the behind. So after we create this and convert these circuits to the tensor circuits in the TensorFlow, so you can use the library to convert to the TensorFlow from circ to TensorFlow circuits, we're gonna start to building our quantum neural network. So first we need to build the model circuit. We're gonna create a class, the circuit layer builder, using of course what we have, the self-data qubits. After that, we need to build an example circuit layer to see how it looks. So we can, for example, here you see a photo just to see how is the format of a two-layered model and how this is the circuit. And you need to wrap the model circuit in the TensorFlow quantum Keras model. Basically here, we know that you are not using quantum data. So build the Keras model with the quantum components is pretty much fed the quantum data between quotes from what they call the X-train circle. And we're going to use a concept named parameterized quantum circuit layer, the PQC, to train the model circuit on the data compute, on the quantum data. So basically, another valid approach that would be shift is using the standard TensorFlow, the function loss, the binary cross entropy, just to help us to parameterize this model and adjust the performance of the model. And using this loss function, we can use, for example, Adam activation function for that. If you see the way that we build the quantum neural network is very similar the way we use for building our traditional neural network, by the way. And we just need to create the architecture of our neural network. And of course, I will need to use the set the batch size, see the number of epochs that I want. For example, I just only 3 epochs for a batch size of 32 rounds. And to build the classical neural network, you're gonna explore Keras TensorFlow. We have, of course, created the neural network architecture. We're gonna use the dropout here as a technique for a regularization, avoiding overfit. And the loss function, as I mentioned, is the binary cross entropy. And the activation function is an ADAM. And the metric that we're gonna use is the accuracy for the purpose to evaluate the performance of the model, okay? At the end of that, we will see that it's very straightforward to build the traditional and the quantum neural network. Now we're gonna compare the results. Basically, I'm gonna use the seaborn plot chart to compare the performance, of course, between, we are measuring the accuracy. So basically, the accuracy of the few classical neural network is almost, is around 98% of accuracy. On the other hand, we see that the quantum neural network has a performance lower than the classical neural network. Why? Basically, because for this kind of data sets that we have, we see that a classical neural network is the ideal model for this kind of data sets. But now, let's compare one thing. Imagine that you have quantum data. So if you go to this another notebook, we will see that you're gonna use the same data set for this purpose, but you're gonna modify the data set, focus on dimension reduction. For example, you're gonna only use the fashion MNIST data set, only that kind of image. And you're gonna approach this data set, changing the labels of the original data sets and computing the PQK, the projected quantum kernel features that will transform the labels, and the data set will be artificially transformed to a quantum data. And after that, you're gonna train the classical network on the relabeled data set and compare the performance with a model that has access to the PQK features. That means we're gonna apply the artificial quantum data set or artificial quantum data to this problem. So pretty much, and go very fast through this, we're gonna follow the same steps that you used in the MNIST first the notebook. Here, for example, as I told you, we're gonna only use the fashion images. We're gonna not using the number image, etc. We needed to adjust the scale of the image to match with this. So we're gonna use the principal component analysis for the transformation to reduce the dimension and resize of this. Now we're gonna relabeling. That's the main difference between the first exercise. We're gonna relabeling and computing the PQK features to transform the original data set in a quantum data set. And we're gonna use this basically creating a new function. Do you remember the single qubit wall that we present in the theory session? And now we're gonna apply this to create this data and creating the building blocks that we need to put this full encoding circuit together. And we'll see that when we relabel this using this kernel, we're gonna reshape the data set so that we can have the quantum data set to be used. Now that we're gonna create the PQK enhanced model the same way, using the Keras, defining the neural network architecture, using the same loss function, the binary cross entropy, and using the activation function ADEM, and create the classical model. This is the basically the quantum neural network. This is the classical neural network. And now we're gonna compare the performance. I'm gonna plot this performance based on the accuracy and the value of the accuracy. And now we see a totally different result. We can see that the accuracy of the classical in this blue line in a certain point starts be much better than the quantum neural network, but after that, after 1600 epochs, basically, the performance of the quantum neural network remains steady in a steadfast way. So the conclusions that we have is that first, it's very unlikely that the quantum models of today will beat classical model performance on classical data, as we saw in the MNIST notebook, right? Especially because on today's classical data sets that can have upwards of a million of data points that we know in real life. Second point, just because the data might come from a hard to classically simulate quantum circuit, like we said, doesn't necessarily make the data harder to learn from a classical model. As we see, the classical model have a little bit of some variations in terms of the accuracy, but is very steady in a certain point. Also, so the classical neural network learned as good as the quantum neural network. And the last point that I would like to highlight is that the data set that are easy for quantum models to learn and hard for classical models to learn exist, do exist. But we need to consider that regardless of the model architecture or the training algorithm that you're gonna use, you see that right now we can still use the traditional and the classical approach to solve this kind of challenge. So, concluding my presentation here for you guys is that Google Cloud is ready to help you to perform this kind of quantum computing challenge. And we are in a very early stage and exploring the opportunities. So, if you guys are interested to learn more about this, I would like to share with you some good information. Here in the TensorFlow website, we have the same tutorial. You can explore a little bit about the concepts as well. And another thing that I would like to give you is that Google has a lot of resources in our websites to improve the education and for all of those people who are interested in exploring more about quantum computing. And if you are interested to learn more, or if you have any additional doubt, please reach me out in my LinkedIn and send me a message, and I'll be more than happy to help you with any need that you may have. Thank you very much, and that's all. And I hope to see you in the future. Thank you.